Good evening. Thank you for coming out. I always appreciate people who take time because I know everybody's got other things that they could be doing. So I really appreciate you coming this evening to get information that then hopefully you can share with your friends and neighbors and other folks that aren't here tonight. My name is Bonnie Bradshaw. And I'm with 911 Wildlife, and 911 Wildlife is a private wildlife control company, and we work very closely with a lot of the municipal animal control departments throughout Dallas, Fort Worth, Houston, Austin, and San Antonio. And we're the only wildlife control company in Texas that is endorsed by the Humane Society of the United States because we operate in a very different way than most wildlife control companies. Okay? All right, so this evening we're going to be talking about bobcats and coyotes. And the first thing I want to talk about is the difference between intuition and science. Intuition is about feelings, right? Science is not about feelings. Science is about facts. And science is about using radio collars and double-blind studies. And so the information that I'm going to present tonight is science-based. There's a lot of counterintuitive information about coyotes and bobcats. So a lot of what I'm going to cover tonight may be the opposite of what most people assume is happening with coyotes and bobcats in residential neighborhoods. Okay, and then the other thing is the difference between fears and facts. As human beings, we do a lot better when we base our actions on facts rather than on fears. And so that's what I'm gonna focus on tonight, is how to recognize the fears, but use our rational, logical minds to focus on the facts and what's really happening with urban bobcats and coyotes in residential neighborhoods. Okay. All right. So what I'm going to cover tonight is why those animals are in the city. I'm going to cover the bad news, which is what doesn't work as far as solving bobcat and coyote problems. We have lots of data because there are lots of cities across North America that have been dealing with urban bobcat and coyote problems. And so we have lots of data on what doesn't work. And then I'm going to talk about the good news, which is what does work. Okay? All right. So the first thing to understand is that when we build new shopping centers and new highways and new housing developments, most of the native animals disappear. They can't adapt to the kind of habitat that we create. They can't adapt to the concrete that we pour, the non-native plants that we put in, and so they just disappear. However, there are a few species that not only adapt to an urban environment, they thrive in it. They find more food, they have larger litters, and more of their offspring survive. And these are the urban adapters. And if we had all night, then I would go through all of these. But tonight we're just going to focus on bobcats and coyotes. But as you can see from this list, these are the animals that are more likely to cause problems in the city. Most of the studies have shown that for squirrels, possums, and raccoons, there's 50 times more of those animals in residential neighborhoods than out in a rural area. Okay? And that's sometimes surprising to people. But all of these animals perfectly adapt to an urban environment. They do very well in the city. Okay. So most people, when they're dealing with a wildlife problem in the city, they think that, one of these box traps is a humane, effective way to solve the problem. Most people want the animal captured and taken away, taken out in the country where it belongs. And so that's why a lot of people buy these traps, a lot of people use these traps, because they always say they don't want the animal hurt, they just want it taken away. So, unfortunately, the radio collar studies have shown that whether we're talking about squirrels or coyotes, animals that are trapped and taken to an area that they're not familiar with have extremely high mortality rate. Several of the studies have shown 100% mortality within 2 weeks. So relocating animals is not a kind thing to do. They're completely disoriented. They don't know where to find food or shelter. They try to get back to where they came from. They end up crossing roads that they're not familiar with. And so that's the way a lot of them die. But the other thing that happens is that somebody will say, well, can't you just take it to someplace that has a pond with lots of trees? I'm sure it will do fine there. Well, if it's a nice habitat like that, it's not empty. There are already animals in that area, and they're going to see this animal as an invader. And so that's the other way that these relocated animals die, is that they're seen as an invader by the animals that are already in that area. And so they die in territorial battles. Okay, also, nature hates a vacuum. So it's not an effective way to solve the problem, because if we capture a coyote or a bobcat and take it away, all that does is put up a flashing vacancy sign. And within a matter of days, there will be other bobcats or coyotes that will move in to take over that territory, because they're always looking for undefended territory. Okay? And I can give you a perfect example of that. You may have seen the news last year in February. There was a horrible incident where a bobcat jumped a fence and killed a Yorkie, and it was caught on security camera. And as a result of that, there were a lot of people in Richardson who insisted that the city put out traps and capture and remove bobcats. Specifically, it was in the Canyon Creek neighborhood. And so during the month of March, they captured and removed 5 bobcats. Okay? And so the people who lived in the neighborhood said, okay, now the problem is solved. By May, 2 months later, people were getting video of multiple bobcats in the neighborhood. 2 months later. And all of those areas had been repopulated by other bobcats. Okay? All right. So, I don't know if everybody's old enough to know what this is. It's an antique. It's a museum piece. So what do these two things have in common? They both waste a tremendous amount of time. They both create errors that are very difficult to correct. And they both are obsolete technology. We have much better ways of solving problems with wildlife, with any species of wildlife, without ever using a box trap. And it's really simple. What are animals always looking for in a habitat? They're always looking for food, water, and shelter, right? So, if we eliminate 2 of those 3 things, the habitat no longer becomes suitable, and they will vacate the area. All right, and then there's a 3rd ingredient, which is aversive conditioning. So I'm going to talk about how these are the most effective ways to eliminate bobcat and coyote sightings in a residential neighborhood. Okay, so here's your typical urban bobcat. And a lot of times people are surprised to find out that they max out at 25 pounds. That is a fat bobcat. But there's something that happens in the human brain when we're startled and we see something that we didn't expect to see. That image in our brain gets much larger. And so that's why people often will think, oh my gosh, it was the size of a German Shepherd. You know, it must have been at least 75 pounds, right? Because they were startled, and so that image gets much bigger in their brain. But I can promise you, bobcats in the South are gonna max out at 25 pounds. So basically, they weigh about the same as a fat house cat. The difference is a bobcat is like it's on stilts. It's got those very long legs. And that's very important to how they find their food. They are pure carnivores. They go after very small prey. And they prefer food that doesn't fight back. They're very intelligent animals. But the question that people always ask is, are they going to attack a child? That's what people are always concerned about. Absolutely not. They do not see children as prey. They do not stalk children. And to further document it, there has never been a case of a wild bobcat injuring a child. Now, the reason that I specify wild is because there's some folks in this world who think that it would be really cool to have a pet bobcat. Do you think that's a good idea? No. That's where a child could get bitten or scratched, is when somebody is trying to keep a bobcat in captivity. It's trying to keep a bobcat as a pet. But in a residential neighborhood, bobcats avoid places where children are playing. They avoid a backyard if there are children outside, because they're interested in finding food. And if there's kids outside, there's not going to be any squirrels or bunnies in the yard, right? Okay? So that's the first thing that we always want to convey, is that bobcats are not a threat to children. Now, this photo was taken in Plano. I want you to notice what's in the background. What do you see back there? Bird feeder, right? That's not a coincidence. Bird feeders are a magnet for bobcats. If somebody is seeing a bobcat in their backyard, that's the first question that we ask them is, do you have a bird feeder? Because at the bird feeder, there's the day shift and then there's the night shift. And there are more animals that come to that bird feeder at night than there are during the day. And the bobcat works both shifts. So during the day, the bobcat will get about 10 feet away from the feeder, underneath some shrubs, and she'll wait until there's a nice fat squirrel or a nice fat mourning dove, and in one 10-foot leap, she's got lunch. That's where those long legs come in. Okay. At night, she uses the same strategy, gets about 10 feet away from the feeder, and waits for the rats to come. So, what we strongly recommend is, if you want to have a bird feeder, to only put out a very small amount of seed in the morning so that it's completely gone before dark. Because any seed that's in the feeder or spilled on the ground is going to attract mice and rats at night. So that's one of the easiest things that people can do to discourage a bobcat from coming in their yard, is to make sure that they don't have a steady supply of rodents. Okay? I wish I had a dollar for every person who calls me and says there's construction going on in that field, and all of a sudden we've been just infested with rats. And the first question I ask them is, how long ago did you put out the bird feeder? Because it has nothing to do with the construction in the field. The mice and rats that are in and around our houses are not native rodents. They're commensal rodents. And commensal means that those rodents are dependent upon human structures. So the mice and rats that people see in their yards and unfortunately in their houses are roof rats, Norway rats, and house mice. And no matter how many times people call it a field mouse or a field rat, that's not what it is. The native rodents that are out in the field never come up to people's houses. They don't want to be anywhere near humans. Okay, so that's a huge misconception. And like I said, it's based on intuition rather than basing it on science. Okay, this photo was taken in Frisco. And this is a mother bobcat with an almost full-grown kitten. And the homeowner that took the picture called and said they're living in the sewer, which is really disgusting to think about an animal living in the sewer. But is that a sewer? It's a storm drain. It's where the rainwater goes. And where does the storm drain let out? At the creek. Which means it is a perfect underground highway for bobcats and raccoons and lots of other animals to come up from the creek into the neighborhood. They definitely use the creek as a highway. That is a very heavily trafficked area, but where they're finding food is up around the houses. Now, all wild animals live by a very strict equation. And the equation is they've got to get the most amount of nutrition for the least amount of energy expended. Because if they waste a lot of energy and don't get very much nutrition, they die. So that's why they go where the concentrated food is. And they find a lot more rodents and rabbits around people's houses than they do down by the creek. Now, in a rural area, a bobcat typically would have a litter of three or four, and maybe one would survive to adulthood, right? But this is an urban bobcat. So take a look at this next picture. She has three almost full-grown kittens. So what does that tell you about the food supply? And this is a perfect illustration of what we see in residential neighborhoods. They find more food, so more of their offspring survive. The bobcats in the city are having much more food supply than their country cousins. Okay? All right, so how can we restrict that food supply so that we're not encouraging bobcats to come into our neighborhood? I don't know if you can tell, but at the bottom of the picture there, that's all sunflower seeds. So what's hanging right above? Bird feeder, right? Okay, so this is a diagram that we use anytime somebody is having a wildlife problem, because wildlife problems are all about the food chain. And these are the most common things that provide food and shelter for mice and rats. And if there's food and shelter for mice and rats, then everybody who eats rodents is going to be attracted to that yard. Snakes, bobcats, everybody who eats rodents. So this is a real helpful way to make sure that you're not inadvertently attracting wildlife to your yard. And so you'll see it has, you know, restrict bird feeding, not leaving cat food or dog food outside, and not having double fencing. If your neighbor has a wooden fence and you have a wooden fence and there's that little gap in between, that is a perfect habitat for rodents. Okay? And then there's, you know, several other things on here. There's one thing that I always apologize before I talk about it because it's really gross, it's really disgusting, but it's really important. So I'm going to talk about it. And it's that item that's over there in the corner where it says pick up dog droppings. The food that we feed our dogs is so concentrated that a lot of it passes through the dog undigested. And mice and rats don't have any scruples. So that dog feces, if it's not picked up, is a buffet for rodents. And a lot of times if people have a small dog, they'll think, oh, it'll just dissolve into the ground. I don't really need to pick it up. But it's not dissolving into the ground. It's being eaten. So that's a really important thing that a lot of people aren't aware of, is if they're not picking up after the dog, that may be the reason that they're seeing a bobcat in their backyard, okay? It's always about the food chain. And if anybody wants a copy of this, I'll have my email at the end, and I'll be happy to email it to you, and that way you can share it with your neighbors too. All right, so this photo was taken in Capel. And I don't know if you can tell, this is a mother bobcat with two kittens. And the homeowner took this picture from the back window. And so that's the deck in the picture. And that's where those kittens were born, is underneath that deck. So if you woke up tomorrow morning and you looked out your back window and you saw this, how would you feel? Is this an asset or a liability? Everybody's different. Some people look at this and go, oh, it's like I have my own private nature documentary. I'm getting to see wild behavior that other people would pay tens of thousands of dollars for, right? Other people say, I don't want this going on in my yard. I want them out of here. This family thoroughly enjoyed having these bobcats in their backyard. It was a very temporary situation because as the kittens grew, they dispersed. They don't stay in the same territory where they were born. So it was only a few months and then they were gone. But if this homeowner had called us and said, I want these bobcats gone, would we have gone and set a trap? If we had set a trap, we might have caught the kittens, but we probably wouldn't catch the mother. And now we've orphaned the kittens, and they probably won't have a very good chance of survival. So instead of setting a trap, what we would do is we would eliminate access to the den site. And the way we would do it is by putting in an L-shaped barrier. So you dig a little trench around the perimeter of the deck, put in heavy gauge welded wire mesh, bend it out, and then backfill, and that permanently eliminates that den site. So there's not going to be any bobcats living underneath there, there's not going to be any raccoons or skunks or any other animal. And that's what we find is the most common den site in residential neighborhoods is underneath a deck or underneath a shed. That's where they're giving birth. They're totally adapted to an urban environment, and so they're very comfortable with human structures. Now, of course, they wouldn't pick a yard where there's dogs or children. But if it's a yard where there's no kids and there's no dog, then it's a perfect, quiet sanctuary. And so they'll look for that kind of backyard and have their den site underneath a deck or underneath a shed. All right, so any questions about bobcats before I move on to coyotes? All right, so maximum of 40 pounds. And like I said earlier, when people are startled, that coyote gets much bigger in their mind. And they'll be sure that it weighed at least 100 pounds. Just doesn't happen. especially with coyotes in the south. Up north, they're a little bit bigger because they've got to survive very harsh winters. But in the south, coyotes are very small. All right. The Latin name for coyote translates to singing dog. They have 11 different vocalizations. And every February, it's very predictable, we'll get a spike in calls about people who are hearing what they think is an entire pack of coyotes. They'll hear them down by the creek, or they'll hear them over in that vacant field, and they'll be convinced that it's at least 5 or 6 coyotes. What they're hearing is 1 or 2 coyotes making 11 different sounds. And the sounds that coyotes make are not just yipping and howling. Coyotes also make a lot of screeching and screaming sounds. And most people, when they hear that sound, they think that it's some poor victim, a rabbit or a squirrel or somebody's cat, being torn to shreds. When coyotes make a kill, it's silent. Those screeching and screaming sounds are being made by the coyotes. Because what holiday comes in the middle of February? Valentine's Day. And coyotes are very romantic. So let me tell you how their year works. The pups are born in April, and the male and the female work very hard together to raise those pups all spring and summer. There's no divorce in coyote marriage. There's not even any cheating in coyote marriage. Coyotes marry for life, but they have a secret. In the fall, when those pups disperse and go to find their own territories, the male and the female take a break from each other. We could learn a lot from coyote marriage. Okay? But come February, they start calling for each other. They start reestablishing those pair bonds. And that's why every February we get a spike in calls about people hearing packs of coyotes. And it's that male and female saying, "Hi, remember me?" And so those screeching and screaming sounds are actually love songs in coyote language. So that's a typical pattern that we see every year. The other thing that we see is that during the summer, coyotes are totally nocturnal. They don't want to be out in the heat, just like we don't want to be out in the heat. But as soon as the temperatures cool off, urban coyotes are out in broad daylight chasing squirrels. So every year during the fall, we always get a spike in calls of people seeing coyotes in broad daylight. And a lot of times when they see that coyote, they think, oh, it must be sick. If it's out in broad daylight, there must be something wrong with it. That's not the case. It's an urban coyote. It's lived its entire life around people. And so it's not afraid to be out where people are, because it knows that's when it can catch squirrels. And also during the winter, all the leaves are off of the plant. And so, whereas in the spring, they may have been hidden behind vegetation, in the fall and winter, they're much more visible. So that's a typical pattern every year. Okay. So, has anybody here ever lived in Chicago? Nobody? All right. 15 years ago, they set aside funding in Chicago to study urban coyotes. And the hypothesis at that time was that urban coyotes were living on eating cats and garbage, right? Intuition tells you they're in the city, they must be eating cats and garbage, right? So they started capturing the coyotes, putting radio collars on them, and tracking their movements. They would find the den sites. They would draw blood from the pups. And that's how we know there's no cheating. And they would study the scat. And scat doesn't lie. So here we 15 years later, the study is still going on. In Chicago, they have 900 coyotes wearing radio collars. So when people ask, how many coyotes do we have in the Dallas area? Easily 1,000. Because these are just the ones that they've been able to catch. All right? So what this study has proven is that more than 40% of an urban coyote's diet is rodents. More than 20% is fruit. Coyotes have a very strong sweet tooth. And if somebody's got a fig tree in their yard, or a plum tree, or a persimmon tree, coyotes will come from miles around to eat that fruit that's fallen on the ground. So in the end of summer, when all that fruit is ripe, that's one of the things that the coyotes are looking for. And they can smell it from a long way away because they've got that incredible canine sense of smell. Rabbits, that's not a surprise. Birds. Insects. During the summer, coyotes can thrive eating grasshoppers and cicadas and June bugs. They're a very adaptable animal, and they're opportunists. So if there's lots of grasshoppers, then that's what they're going to be eating. But where is the cats and garbage? Yes, coyotes do occasionally kill cats, but it's not part of their regular diet. Coyotes are also scavengers. So if a cat has been killed by a car, then coyotes will definitely take advantage of that. Coyotes are very intelligent, and they would much prefer food that doesn't fight back. So yes, they do occasionally kill cats, but it's not nearly as often as most people think. All right, so like I said, this study is still going on, but it's already proven that urban coyotes live longer, healthier lives than their country cousins. Kind of the opposite of what a lot of people would assume. Okay, so you want to talk about sex? All right, remember that Valentine's Day is when they mate, and then the pups are born in April. Look at that litter size. Coyotes normally have a litter of 6, but there's a very bizarre thing that happens. If the coyotes in an area are being trapped or hunted or poisoned, the remaining females in the surrounding area double the size of their litter. And that's why we have more coyotes in this country today than we did 200 years ago. Now, USDA, Wildlife Services, federal agency, they kill 90,000 coyotes in this country every year. And they've been doing that for decades. 20,000 of those are in Texas. And so this is just federal employees. This does not include private individuals that kill coyotes or private wildlife control companies that kill coyotes. This is just the number that is tracked by that federal agency. So what effect has this had? In the 1800s, coyotes were only found west of the Mississippi. Today, coyotes are throughout the South and the East. There are even coyotes living in Central Park in New York. They are thriving, and they are finding more food, having larger litters in urban environment than out in rural areas. Okay, so, all right, so that was the bad news. Once again, the good news is if we restrict the food supply, and remember, more than 40% of their diet is rodents. So all of those things that applied to bobcats also apply to coyotes. We want to make sure that we're not providing food and shelter in our yard for mice and rats. How to keep pets safe. If somebody has a dog that weighs less than 20 pounds, unfortunately, it should never be outside unsupervised. If somebody has a dog that weighs less than 20 pounds, they should not have a doggy door. Because that little dog should never be going outside by itself. If it's outside of the yard, it needs to be on a leash, and it needs to be maximum of a 6-foot leash. It should not be one of those retractable leashes. And there's a lot of people who say, you know, I shouldn't have to go out and stand by my dog whenever it's in my own backyard. In an ideal world, maybe. But the reality is, even if you don't have coyotes or bobcats in the yard or in the neighborhood, there are lots of hawks and great horned owls. And so, unfortunately, if you choose to have a dog that weighs less than 20 pounds, it should have a warning label on it that says, never leave me outside unsupervised. Okay? And as far as cats, multiple studies have shown that indoor cats live much longer, healthier lives. The only way to keep a cat safe is to keep it indoors. And there's lots of information on how to transition a cat from being an outdoor cat to being an indoor cat. And the studies have shown that for free-roaming cats, the number one cause of death is car collisions. Number seven is predation by wildlife. Number six is cruelty inflicted by humans. Okay? And I think the thing that I struggle with so often is that we'll get calls from somebody and they'll say, my cat's disappeared and I know a coyote killed it. And I'll say, what, you know, has happened that leads you to think that? And they'll say, well, because for weeks I've been getting emails from my neighbors saying there's coyotes in the neighborhood. Why did you let your cat out if you've been getting emails for weeks about coyotes in the neighborhood? I have three cats, and I would be devastated if anything happened to one of them. And that's why they never set foot outside. That is the only way to keep a cat safe. Okay? All right. So, as far as den sites, just like with bobcats, coyotes are most likely going to be having their den underneath a deck or a shed. If they're living in a residential neighborhood, that's where the pups are going to be born. And so, once again, the way we would solve this problem is by putting in an L-shaped barrier that completely eliminates access to that area underneath the deck or underneath the shed. Okay, so this is a typical urban coyote out in broad daylight watching the traffic because they know to look both ways before they cross the street. This is an urban bobcat laying on somebody's patio looking in through the back window. Would you see this behavior in a rural area? No. Because they would get shot and they would get eliminated from the gene pool. But these animals have learned that in the city, they can show themselves in broad daylight around people, and people do in the city do one of two things. They either pull out their phone and take pictures, or they run away. They grab their children and run indoors. And what does that teach the animal? That they're the alpha. Okay? All right. So the good news is that can be easily reversed. Because these animals have a natural fear of people. But we've taught them to act this way in the city. We can unteach them. And it's very easy to do. It's called hazing. And it basically means if you walk your dog at 6 o'clock in the morning and you always see coyotes in that park that you walk by, then carry a little air horn or carry a whistle. If you see a bobcat or a coyote in your yard and you can grab the garden hose, spray it with water. Okay? Now, there's another tool that also works really well. Super soakers. You know, and people always laugh when I tell them to get a super soaker, but those can shoot 30 feet. We had a retirement center that was in Dallas, and it was the type of retirement center where people could have their pets, and it seemed like everybody who lived there had a little fluffy white dog. And they had a courtyard, and there was a coyote that would come and lay in the courtyard and watch everybody walk back and forth with their little dogs. And so the people who lived there were terrified. They're like, this coyote is going to get my dog. It's going to attack me. I'm elderly. I'm frail. I won't be able to fight it off, right? So we came and we talked to them and we said, the best way to solve this problem is to have a loaded super soaker by the courtroom door, by the courtyard door. Okay? So 2 days later, I got a call from a sweet little old lady, and her voice was shaking on the phone, and she said, I got him. I got him with the super soaker. And they never saw that coyote again, because making physical contact is like counting coups. It's like, I touched you, I can kill you. And that is a life-changing experience for a coyote or a bobcat. But I'm walking, and I don't have a super soaker. I don't have an air horn or a whistle. All you need to do is wave your arms, clap your hands, shout, and take 2 steps towards the animal. Now, most people, when I tell them that, they say, but it's going to attack me. That's the difference between a bobcat and a coyote versus a stray dog. I would never suggest that somebody act aggressively towards a stray dog. That is the dangerous animal in our midst, because that stray dog doesn't have a natural fear of humans. And so it might attack. But coyotes and bobcats, if we act aggressively towards them, they learn to stay away from our house, from our yard, from our neighborhood. And you can even do this in a dress and heels. It's very simple. It's very effective. So that's the result. You're going to see the back end of the coyote or the bobcat disappearing. And this isn't just an experiment. This isn't something that I'm suggesting that you try because it might work. This is something that has been proven to work all across the country. Okay? Because there are lots of cities across the country that spent tens of thousands of dollars having coyotes and bobcats trapped and removed. And it was a total failure. So, they were willing to try something new, and it worked. It's got 3 steps. Eliminating concentrated food supply, eliminating access to den sites, and using aversion techniques. And that's the way you eliminate coyote and bobcat sightings in a residential neighborhood. Does anybody have any questions? Nobody? Yes?
Can the coyote scale fences the way that bobcats
can? Oh, very good question. Question is, can a coyote scale a fence the way that bobcats do? That coyotes can definitely go over a 6-foot fence, but it has to fit into that equation. They're not going to jump a fence just to see if there's food on the other side? It has to fit that equation of most amount of nutrition for the least amount of energy expended. So they've either got to smell that there's cat food or dog food left out, or that there's a bird feeder, or that there's a fruit tree. They're not going to jump a fence just out of curiosity. One other thing that I didn't touch on is a lot of times people are concerned about rabies. Especially, you know, if they see a bobcat or a coyote out in broad daylight in the middle of the street. The good news is that, number one, bobcats are not a rabies vector species. It just, bobcats, for whatever reason, just don't come up positive with rabies. Coyotes, back in the 90s, there was a huge problem in Texas with canine rabies. Because unfortunately in Mexico, they don't have a rabies vaccination program like we do here. And so on a fairly regular basis, there were stray dogs and coyotes and foxes that were testing positive for rabies, especially along the border. So starting back in the 90s, the Texas State Health Services Department set aside funding to pay for airplanes to fly every January and drop an oral rabies bait that vaccinates canines. And so every January, that bait is dropped all along the border, and that has completely wiped out canine rabies in Texas. Now, we do occasionally see coyotes that have distemper, because every year we seem to have an epidemic of distemper among raccoons, and so sometimes the coyotes will catch it from the raccoons. And the good news is that distemper is not contagious to people. Distemper is not contagious to cats and dogs that have been vaccinated. And distemper makes animals extremely lethargic, the opposite of rabies. You know, rabies can have a furious stage where the animal is very aggressive and is biting anything it can bite. Distemper is the opposite, makes the animal extremely lethargic. They'll have facial spasms where it looks like they're chewing gum, but they don't bite people, they don't attack people. The bad news is it's fatal to the coyotes and to the raccoons. There's not any treatment for them. But so if somebody does see a coyote out in broad daylight and it's acting like it's drunk, it's falling down, it's having facial spasms, that would be an indication that it has distemper. And unfortunately, it just needs to be euthanized. But it's very fortunate that we don't have a problem with rabies in any of the canines in Texas. Okay, any other questions? All right, I brought two handouts. I brought a flyer that has the top 10 ways to prevent wildlife problems, and I also brought a coupon for a free inspection. So if you know of anybody who is concerned about seeing coyotes or bobcats in their yard or in their neighborhood, we'll come out and do a free inspection to see if we can help identify what the attractant is. We also help if people have squirrels or raccoons in their attic or underneath their deck or their shed, any of those kind of problems. So I'll get those flyers and hand them out. And in the meantime, if anybody has any questions, I'll be happy to stay afterwards and answer questions individually.